Hello.
Hello. I'm Andy Serkis.
And I'm Simon Pegg. And this is Empire's coverage of...
Burke and...
Hare.
And Hewitt.
Huh?
Burke and Hare and Hewitt. We discussed this. It's all agreed.
I don't think so.
It's not really historically accurate, is it?
Time travel from the future?
I tell you what we could do to you.
What's that?
Birkin!
Hello, Webb. You know, it's been over a decade since a great John Landis made a film, but now he's back with a pitch-black period comedy, Burke and Hare, starring Simon Pegg and Andy Serkis. And that's why I'm here, at the wonderfully named Luton Hoo, to visit the set. But that's not all. Oh no. In their infinite wisdom, they've asked me to become an extra, clearly unaware about how Hostel Part 2 turned out. Anyway, I'm off now to get spruced up and turned out. This here is dead. Long live Muck Daddy, the Scottish pimp from the 1800s. So who are Burke and Hare? Well, in Edinburgh in the early 19th century, they were two Northern Irish immigrants who quickly graduated from grave robbing to full-blown murder. Not usually the stuff of comedy, you might think. This man begs to differ.
American Werewolf was a horror film that happened to be funny. And people always call it a comedy horror. It isn't. I mean, that's not a happy story. But this is very much a comedy. There's a couple of moments of surprise, and there's certainly some grisly things.
Well, this is what I think is great about the movie, is that it just genuinely challenges you to readdress your thoughts about, you know, it constantly challenges you to like them and to root for them even, you know, and to be on their side, when really they're just killers, you know.
These characters who, at the end of the day, are serial killers, whether you like it or not. They killed 17 people, and so you've got to kind of... So it's... Yeah, it's a challenge.
It never says that what they do is right or there was a reason for it. There is no reason. I mean, there are motivations, but they're not justifiable. But it constantly asks you to go, well, you know, they need a bit of money, and you constantly keep on going, no, they're bad.
I think it being placed in history kind of gives you license to do that. Set in 1828, you've got that lovely kind of veneer of time passing, and so, you know, we can get away with it. But, and also, it's a completely ironic, obviously, take on the whole thing.
And I really like that, because it just forces you to sort of to question morality. It's very easy to sort of throw high concepts like evil at people when they do terrible things. It's scarier when you realise that they're just people.
No, it is an Ealing comedy. It is an Ealing comedy.
It's a very British movie, though. It really is British.
Him here. He's aspirational, kind of got a great grasp of capitalist principles and mob psychology, and he's basically the sort of the brains behind the operation.
William Burke is, I guess, of the two of them, he's the slightly more kind of innocent. Not that either of them are particularly innocent, because they do terrible things, but he's the slightly dreamier one. He's the one that's led more than... Hare's the kind of schemer. He's the brains. Burke's just sort of along for the ride, really.
They're very much like Laurel and Hardy. I'm not kidding, because like Oliver thinks he's much smarter than Stanley, but they're both not very bright. And you know, ultimately, what I wanted to get was a sweetness from them. And these two actors, I have to say, they've delivered.
He can't really write his name, but he's really great with figures and numbers and business plans. So they kind of they go through throughout the course of the film. They go sort of kind of incrementally change from sort of scamsters into murderers.
He does it for love in a way.
He does exactly. Yeah, he does, and it's because of Isla Fisher's character, Ginny, that he kind of realizes he needs to earn more money, and the only way he can do that is by selling cadavers.
I'm a big fan of Simon Pegg. Yeah, I think he's terrific, and I'm a big fan of Andy Serkis. And it's interesting for Andy, because this is really the first time he's played a leading man. I mean, he's played Gollum and King Kong and Ian Drury and people, but this is the first time he's playing someone totally sympathetic, you know. And, I mean, yes, he murders people, but everyone has flaws, you know. It's an unusual, it's a difficult line to walk, but I'm happy with it.
Anyway, I've just picture wrapped on my role as Gravedigger's punter in Burke and Hare, and I'm trying to get the taste of that goddamn pipe out of my mouth. I don't smoke in real life, and now I know why. It tasted like seven all crammed into my mouth at once. Don't try that at home. Still, there's an upside. John Landis came over to me at one point and said, "That was the worst goddamn background performance I've ever seen." But three takes later, he upgraded that, so that was very good, sir. I'll take that from the master. Of course, don't take his word for it. Judge for yourself when Burke and Hare opens in cinemas near you. Well, that's it from our special Burke and Hare Videblogisode. John, what do you think of my performance? Don't hold back.